Hello everyone, it's Sarah Altair, and this is the Midweek Zap. I want to welcome all our Zapster audience, and I want a special thank out, I can't talk, special shout out to Carol Foucault, who is a new patron with Patreon, so thank you so much, Carol. And our guest today is Peter Hatherley, and I am so excited about this conversation. We're going to be talking about words and word use. So, Peter, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah. Well, hello, everybody. And, you know, I've obviously chatted with quite a few of you and had some interesting conversations over the last 12 months. I've been on here for about 12 months. I just love it. I mean, G Plus is just a wonderful playground for enjoying yourself, and you know, business is far more fun now, and just the conversational stuff that we have is just huge. I'm a web developer from Christchurch. I've been in internet design and development since 1996, so a long-term experience in that way. I became very interested in words around 2002. Just had sort of an epiphany one day, and it was just from there on. I just had this journey about exposing, you know, the matrix of understanding behind language, and it really is. You know, it's been an exciting journey. So that's a bit about me. I've got five children and six grandchildren. Been happily married with Julie, my wife, for 34 years. So that's a bit of an intro.
Well, it's just delightful to have you with us today. And we're going to be talking about words, but I wanted to start out defining some terms so we're all on the same page during our chat today. And the first thing is, you talk a lot about semantic authorship, so tell us what that means, Peter.
Semantics, obviously the Greek, comes from a Greek word, and it means simply meaning. And we've sort of popularized it as semantics. Well, David Ameland in particular has popularized it as semantics. What it really is a wider view of things. I remember the first example of this that really showed it to me. You can have a word like Java, which can be an island, can be a coffee, can be some software. If you bring an extra word into that equation, such as, say, aroma, you know immediately what it is. So the new understanding of semantics is actually putting these groups together in that way, so you get a wider understanding of what a word means by what it's connected to. So, in general terms, that's exactly what semantics is. Yeah. In regard to authorship, it's bringing that into the equation. So you work with a whole lot of thematic tools. SEO is really enhanced by semantics. But, you know, it's an automatic sort of thing. So people can use thesauruses. You know, you can actually start doing this yourself today. I mean, if you're not doing it, your competitors will be doing it. There are huge resources, and just watching the pieces come together is just so exciting at the moment. There's just so many resources becoming available that we can build and make and do the semantic optimization. So when I talk about semantic optimization, what I'm talking about is adding words within the theme set into your content. Now, you've got to do this reasonably naturally. We're going to cover these various angles as we go on. But that's a reasonably quick intro to what semantics means.
That's a great explanation. Mm. I like the Java and aroma explanation about the connectivity, because that is exactly what the search engines look for, those pieces that explain the usage.
Yeah.
And then one more term, and then we can just dive into words, and that is predictive semantics.
Yeah, predictive semantics is an interesting one. What it is it there is a connection that I found in this which is connected to semantic profile. So in that sense, people have their own semantic profile, and we understand that Google's got our semantic profiles. That's why sometimes when we're searching on Google, we find results that will suit us. And the more that's happening, it's personalized search. So what Google does is predict what you might enjoy. But by actually building a word set around these things, you can actually potentially predict, and we've done this and tested this, predict what a person may like. And basically through language rather than big data, which is a slightly different angle. It gets a similar result, but big data is a problem because big data and its big processing, it's sort of like you've got to go through this mountain of information and find, you know, quality information. We're looking for quality information. Everyone's looking for quality information. The better your information is, the more likely you are to succeed. The more you write to people, the more likely it is to be effective. You know, we went through that SEO stage of trying to force keywords into different places. You know, it was like working in it's like being in a straitjacket for me, because I'm a creative person and I just like to be able to write freely. And I'll go into detail about how this works with the things that we've created over a period of time.
Yeah. I know that happened with me with keywords, because I just don't think like that. I don't think two keywords in the title and two or three in the first paragraph, and then sprinkle them around in the body of the text and make sure you have two at the end. And when I tried writing like that, it would just come out so stilted and not the way I communicate with people. So I think it's very freeing for all of us that we're able to talk in a conversational style and to write in a conversational style, and that the connections are recognized among the words that we group together.
Yeah, that's right. You know, it's one of those things. We're writing more than we've ever written. I mean, you take it back 10 years, and we were looking at, maybe writing a few emails. Social media was, social platforms were just coming into their own. But you look at what we're writing now. The average person is on a social media, platform. They're writing things all the time. So the better we can understand language, the better we can communicate. And qualification is everything in my view. Sometimes people can lose the context or concept of what you're saying because you're straying outside the topic. And this is what semantic thinking is about. It's keeping within the topic and making that work for you. Yeah.
So our high school teachers are right. Stay on topic.
Of course they are. I mean, you were talking in the green room about our Latin teachers and things. And, Latin's a perfect example. Funnily enough, as a language, it doesn't work like English. You can actually jumble it up and it'll still mean the same thing. So it's a slightly different language than what we've got, which relates a lot more to grammar.
It has another layer of declensions, which doesn't make the word order not as important in the sentence structure. Wherever the word is, you know what it's doing, which is not true with a language like English.
That's right. Yeah, and English has become the default language, really, hasn't it? And the beauty is a very rich language. I mean, I indexed the whole of the English language because it was a new pattern. I had no resource where I could work with, so I had to basically start from scratch. I had to start with big word lists and then develop this pattern in the database. So the database it took me a long time. I mean, probably the database took me, I started in 2002, the database was finished about 2007. And then we had the earthquakes, and actually the earthquakes changed it all for me, because it gave me time. No one wanted to do a website. They just wanted to get the utilities going again. They wanted their power on, or the water going again. But it gave me a chance to actually sit back and think about, what do I really want to do with this? And And that's when I decided it would be best as a search engine. And then I started, I just happened to run into an old friend of mine. It's an old colleague who's a programmer, a word lover as well. And we just got chatting, and he just bought into it, and we started developing the whole structure from there. We've had probably 30 or 40 different algorithms to get to where we are at, and it wasn't straightforward. There were a whole lot of factors, and we learned all the way. That's the beauty of doing a software project. You're just constantly learning, and if you're exposing yourself to that amount of language, you're actually ordering your conceptual memory, and you know that was a subject I was going to mention. It was really interesting because Manny St. Vincent sort of got me down this track on thinking about how it worked in the mind, and it really, really was useful for me. And he was talking about conceptual memory and how it was long-term memory. Once I realized it was long-term memory, I understood how words were connected to that. So in other words, our conceptual memory, if we use a word, usually there'll be a something in our memory. As soon as we mention that word, it'll come to its top of mind. So it will actually just be instantly available to us. It means every concept that we have or have learned is actually accessible to us. And so we can tap into that at any point we like. And when we know that, we can also adapt our understanding of conceptuals. So in other words, we start to be able to alter our behaviors. And I found that particularly useful in developing this resource.
Tell us about the resource. So I think we're putting the cart before the horse
I think actually that people might have started to think it was vaporware, but it definitely isn't vaporware. it takes time. I mean, I'm one. If it takes another 6 months to do something, I'd rather get it right. I don't like going into something half-cocked. I prefer that it's right at the level where people can understand it, and that was my main thing in beta testing it here in Christchurch. The funniest thing for me was actually going out and selling to my competitors. And I really struggled with that concept originally. Am I going to give them away my secret? But it works so well. And to me, that was the foundation for coming to G+, where we're sharing ideas, we're trying to collectively and collaboratively, in a collaboration, getting to a point of understanding and improving everyone's understanding. And each of us is a piece in that puzzle. You know, we all have a different role to play. I believe every individual is important. Every piece in the puzzle is important. No one should be left out. And you've probably seen at different times how I've talked about inclusivity and various things like that. I'm a great believer in it. I found that if you do have issues, it's better to try and resolve it. And if you resolve issues, it is something that we come across here on G+. But and language is the best way to do it. You know, I can isolate what the problem is and put it down to one word or two words. It will do searches on two words. If I get it down to that level, I can then get a semantic set, which is gives me understanding about that subject. So I can put in, say it's forgiveness. I can type in forgiveness, and I'll get a set which will convince me that it's a bad idea to be unforgiving. And that's the benefit, you know. huge benefits. I mean, it's changed my life, really has. I mean, and because you're doing it to yourself. I've got a saying, control yourself, not others. The whole point is, it's up to us to do things right, not other people. And, you know, that's the way to get around it. So it started as more of a thing that actually enhanced that. It turned into an SEO product. I started optimizing just before Hummingbird. And so when Hummingbird hit, I woke up one morning and all my sites had gone up by at least 12 or 13 positions, every single one of the ones I'd optimized. So I knew immediately that this concept worked. I hadn't really thought of it as an SEO product at that point until that happened. Even though I was into SEO, it's quite weird. I just, You know, I can't understand why I didn't see it that way, but maybe it was just the process, serendipity. You know.
We have a question from Midweek. He has, how relevant are written words if you have videos on your website?
Well, they're very important now because Google was actually indexing these things. David had an article recently, and a few others have written articles which prove that if you're putting an image up online, Google is now converting that into words. So basically, they will, if your picture doesn't fit now, and this is why it's so much more important to get pictures matching with words, if your picture fits more accurately, you'll get a better semantic result. Now, same with video. They are actually working out, I saw an example, it was sort of, I think it was probably about April, and last year, and what it was I think it was a wheelchair basketball, and it was showing how it was picking up that it was wheelchair, it was basketball, it was picking up all these words and putting them into the index. So to me, there's less of a differentiation with words and video and imagery than there has been in the past.
Okay, thank you. That was a very good answer. And I didn't know about the video. New information for me.
Yeah. I'll put that link up in the thread afterwards.
Thank you very much. So we're about halfway through, Peter, and I thought you might like to show us a little bit about what you have.
Yeah. Well, I'll describe it because I probably didn't describe it that accurately. It's a search engine, so we've covered that. What I've called it is SICE. It's an acronym. It's Conceptual Intelligence Search Engine. It's a conceptual intelligence. So everything we write is in concepts. If you see all of the concepts in a situation, you're going to get a far better understanding of what those concepts might mean as a collective thing. And that has an effect on a conceptual memory. So I suppose I should go into the screen share. Maybe with this. Right. Yeah. Hopefully everyone can see that. It looks a bit smaller than it was last time. So
looks fine.
Yeah. So, for instance, if we're searching for words, we can... Oh, hold on. I think it's just a little bit of a technical glitch there. Sorry about this. Swap over to that. Share. Yeah. It's not... unfortunately, it's not searching for me at the moment, so I'm just trying to... It's more like it's the image. Sorry about this. We did test it earlier, and we were looking at it, weren't we? So it's just a bit of a problem, right?
You know, we were late starting because we were looking at it.
That's right. Sorry about this.
Okay, you're going to have to use words to describe it, Peter.
I'm not absolutely sure what's happening. It was full screen before, so I think that was half the issue. I'll just alt tab it, and I think I might be able to get through. Oh, here it is. Sorry about this. I've got it now. Thanks for that. Okay, so words. So now we can do it. So it isn't vaporware. So I'll just tap it there. So basically, you type in words, and you get a list like this, okay? So this is the thematic set. And okay, so let's have a look at a few of these words here. At the top here, we've got words that are positive. They're in the purple. And the ones in the middle are thematic. And the ones at the bottom are negatives. So we've got plus, neutral, and minus. So basically, if we look at the top ones, widespread, words are widespread, words are awarded, words obviously used worldwide. They can be a reward. Words have an award. You can see all the connections there. So what basically you do from here, say you're thinking, oh, I want to talk about a worldwide award, you then select them like this, and then basically copy it to the clipboard, which is down here, and then you copy them to the clipboard, and you can use them anywhere you want. We're actually building this also into a WordPress plugin, so that's going to be able to be used directly within WordPress, so that's going to make it very easy for a lot of people out there that use WordPress. Afterwards, I find afterwards really interesting, because words are all about what happens afterwards. They're like seeds. So thematically, in the sense there, you've got afterwards. So it's sort of, I remember discussing this originally, and Kristen Drysdale said, I was saying it's like cherry picking. She said, no, it's more like kiwi fruit picking. So, and really, just a play on the fact that I'm a kiwi. But, that's what it is. You build context. And in my view, context is in the eye of the beholder. So, in other words, someone could look at this and think completely differently about it. They can pick. In our testing here locally, we found that people would use them very, very differently. And it's almost like their semantic profile influences what they pick here, if you understand what I'm saying. So basically, if we look at another one, for instance, this is one I found really interesting, just looking at the other day.
While you're doing that, I have a question.
Okay, all right. I can go back to the result. It's there, still sitting there.
Well, yeah. Because, if we're thinking about the relational conceptualization of those words, say worldwide award and afterwards, how do we link up with, this is just popped into my head, how do we link up with the conceptualization of other people, especially when you just illustrated that other people often have totally different conceptualizations?
Yeah, well, it's
and work with that.
Yeah, it's like they're going to look at this, and they might be what I should go through the process of how I use it personally, because it'll give a better understanding how it works. If I go in and I have a look at this, say I'm going to be talking about words, and I do use it for presentations, and I might use it for writing, whatever I potentially am using it for. So I'll go in and I'll absorb. It's the research stage. So there's three stages to writing, in my view. There's the research stage, and this is like instant research, okay? So it's very left-brained. Originally, this is all, yes, these all connect. They're logically correct. They're related to words. And if you go through any individual one of those words, you'll find that it's connected. It's a huge array of it. It's a case of just absorbing it, working on it, and then you go into what I call the second stage, is incubation, and it's a process used by other copywriters and people like Joe Sugarman spoke about how incubation works. What you do is you do your research in your left brain side, and then you don't write with this like, well, you can. I mean, someone could write structurally like that if they're more left brain orientated, but what I'll do is I'll absorb all this information. Just look at it, or absorb other research as well. So I'm researching a subject. This is part of it. It's only a part of the puzzle. I'll absorb that information, and then it's like going over a threshold. If you go over the threshold, sometimes you forget what you're thinking about. So you go through a doorway and think, oh, what was I thinking about? Thresholds change things. So if you go out and have a coffee, maybe have some bacon in some people's cases, whatever. Just change your position, change what you're doing, go and do another job, whatever. And then you come back and you write without even looking at this. So it really is a resource that you feed in like seeds and then write later quite naturally. And if you want to refer back to it, you can just pick and choose as you go. So I find if I look at the subject, there's always something there that I think, wow, that's an interesting connection with words. Well, there's a historical connection, say, for instance, with sword. People can have disorders with words. So, by the way, these are all in order. So in other words, the first one is the most connected one, right? And in each of the color sections. So obviously words, this is the top one for words, and afterwards is the top thematic. And I find that really intriguing, because if you split it, and you know, a lot of comedians use word splits and things to get their material, after words, what happens afterwards, you know? And so what we sometimes don't realize is the effect of words, you know, and effect of words is how they affect us and how they affect others. What is going to happen through this? And obviously the second one there, inwards, is just hugely connected, because words happen inwardly. They're thoughts, and we tend to think in thoughts, in words, I mean. We're thinking in words. And then you get other sort of slightly different ones, like password. So all of those ones are all connected. You've got to remember that this is just pulling it out of a database and just using the pattern that we've developed. So it doesn't matter what you put in, it always works. So really what it exposes is a pattern behind language that I don't see myself as an inventor as such. It's just I discovered it. I discovered this pattern and have just run with it ever since. So
we hopefully that helps. We have a question from Sean, and he asks, Google now shows instructions of how to add social profiles to the knowledge graph panel. Is this good for SME Starbucks versus ABC House B&B, for example?
Mm.
Any thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, actually, I just put the code in for that about 48 hours ago, so I'm interested to see how it works. I think any connection semantically, any connection that connects with what you're saying, will, you know, automatically improve your profile. And especially if you're keeping on topic to what you're talking about, it doesn't really matter, because naturally it's building and building and building. They've got more information about us than we've got about them. In this particular case, we're turning the tables a bit. This is like looking at what Google thinks is in that semantic group. If you can understand my point of view, that's how it works. So even though you could consider potentially putting lots and lots of these words in, some of them will give you an advantage in SEO because other people aren't using them. And when Google sees that you're using that word and they know that it's in that group, your site suddenly becomes unique in their eyes. And from an SEO point of view,
that's really astounding, because you know, it would be very unusual for me to think of words and disarray, for instance.
Yeah. Well, if you look at some people's writing, it's like disarray.
Well,
you know, I suppose I've just been exposed to this so long, and you know, I remember one time when I was looking at hiccups. I know it's a strange topic, but and out popped peach. So I thought, oh well, I'll Google this, and of course, peach is a cure for hiccups. You know, this is the sort of thing that's hidden behind language, and people who use this engine will quickly see that that's how it is. You know, we just haven't seen it before. It was hidden in plain sight. Really, what happened for me is I got this understanding by going back into ancient languages, and when I realized in ancient languages that they had another system of organizing words, and their lexical dictionaries organize words in a way that, you know, has traditionally caused those languages, Middle Eastern languages, to be considered really rich. What I found is English is in exactly the same position if we index in that same manner. So I've gone a bit further, obviously. There's lots and lots that have gone on with this algorithm to get it to this point.
Just looking at what you're sharing, and the relationship of the words, you know, and how they are clustered, is just eye opening for me. Rosy words, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, sometimes they're just like ideas, you see, and you know, the thing is, because they're going to be connected, and this is where we've been working on the algorithm, so they get closer and closer and closer. So we found out ways of, and this is the hardest part in this task actually, is finding out ways to make sure that it keeps the topic itself. And you know, there are things I've got major databases that pull out all the Greek, you know, gods, all of the various esoterical stuff that in history. But you won't find that in here. This is meant more for a conceptual thing. I will release those sort of things later, because they're very specialist, and only people who really want to dig into those areas will want that sort of material. But you know, it doesn't matter what you put in. You know, words worry us. Someone says something. You know, there's so many things, and a war of words. All of that stuff is stuff that we know. What is amazing to me is this is a resource that puts it all together, and we've never had that possibility before. We know that they're connected, but we've never seen them all together like this before.
Well, I think it's just astounding that, you know, it visualizes and makes practical for us what Google has already determined as related.
Yeah. And that's the exciting thing for me. Once I saw what happened with Hummingbird, I knew that it would work. Like there's one site we've got, they've been number one for every search phrase, and it was the first one we did. And to be honest, I put a lot of extra work into that site just as a test. And it's been number one ever since for every search phrase in their long tail, and I use this concept. But I had to build it from scratch at that stage. We didn't have the database to create it. I had the thesaurus, so I had to just do it sort of manually initially. But now we've got a database. People can just search for what they want. It's going to be a paid search situation, so the packages sort of start off with $100 and a monthly amount of words that you can search for. And you know, people can do their own research on their own subjects. And you'll find that whatever you put in, it'll get a result similar to this.
That's just astounding. I'm wondering if you can stop the share for a second, because I have an amazing conceptual leap here from Kristen. I'm making leaps in logic here. So what I'm understanding is when we can more effectively tie words to concepts, then we can more effectively retain those concepts for longer periods of time. Could learning more words for same concepts possibly help ward off dementia in old age? I love that a lot, Kristen.
Oh, definitely, definitely. And I'm totally convinced of that. You know, one thing I've really found, I have a neighbour and they've got a friend who's dyslexic. And he started looking at these lists, and it really did improve his understanding. Because most dyslexics have problems with B's, P's, Q's, and B's. B's, P's, and Q's, and D's. So they mix those up, and there are little apps that you can buy that sort that out. But this, in a way, does that. And, you know, to me, I can see that the ability to expand your conceptual understanding, which is this is what it does for me. You imagine, I've been exposed to this for 12 years, and I've just been sort of chomping at the bit, wanting to get it out so everyone else can see it. But it really is exciting stuff, and it just is a leap in understanding in my view, and that's why I've talked about semantic understanding. This is why you know, I suppose it was a bit of a riddle for a lot of people, but now you can see the practicalities of what it really meant.
It's just astounding. And just to add on to answer Kristen's question, yes, as long as we're dealing with dementia and not Alzheimer's, the more we exercise our brain continuing on into older years, the more we are putting off any kind of dementia. We're keeping those neurons firing, and I'm sure Manny, whom we've already mentioned before today, Manny St. Victor, could give us even more information about the physiological aspects of those neural connections. But keep playing with your brain. It's fun.
I saw it happen with my own family. I had an aunt who was in her 90s, and she just loved listening to things, kept on top of it. She said, you've just got to keep active. And the moment she went into a home and stopped thinking like that, she went backwards. It was really quite intriguing. So determining that you're going to keep active and with your mind is a very important thing. I really agree with that.
We have another question from Amelia Hoskins. She asks, not clear how this is used at all. Hope there will be a link to some explanation, Peter Hatherley.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, I've got videos that will be there in the help files. So basically, it'll just, you've got to think of it a bit like a thesaurus. The best way to think about this is it's a thesaurus. I almost called it the semantic thesaurus. But I'll tell you, the main reason I did it, and it's quite a strange reason, but you'll understand it from an SEO point of view. Thesaurus is in the top 20 search terms on the internet. It's a very, very hard word to index for, extremely hard. If you type in, say, thesaurus and semantics, you will actually get 50, 60 thesauruses and the meaning of semantics underneath that, or synonyms for that. So think of it as a thesaurus on steroids. It's sort of like, this Java aroma thing. It's all in a theme. It's a theme. And so once you've got that in your mind, and actually, when I was talking with Alan Johns about this, and, I've shared this with, luminaries online, like such John Calden. I've shared it with David Amelie, and David has just been highly supportive. In fact, we've got an event coming up, and he'll be promoting that next week. And so, he is really fully behind it. He started writing with it. He used the samples that I gave him, and he said, look, it's just amazing. And so,
one of the things about David is he's exercises his conceptual thinking all the time.
Exactly.
Fun to hang out with. We have a very key question here from Lon McClure. How do we experience this tool firsthand?
Well, it's going to be available, and it's available from today. People can contact me, and I'll give you details. So basically, it works as a paid search. We've got a monthly package, a weekly package, and a daily package. So a certain amount of searches per day, a limitation of searches per day, and a limitation of monthly and weekly. So basically, you can start using it straight away in that sense of if you're interested in doing that. It'll be available commercially from here on out.
That's a super fantastic tool. Will you be posting a link for people to contact you?
Yes, I will do. Definitely.
Okay. Super. Well, I want to thank you so much, Peter. I feel like we've just been the tip of the iceberg today.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
But
I wanted to show time travel.
Amazing project.
Yeah, time travel. I got irretrievable. That was the top negative, and I thought that's just incredible. It's the biggest fear people have got with time travel, is that they won't come back. I get an epiphany every time I search. To be honest, it amazes me every time I do it. But to me, it's a pattern that's existed. It's not something I've invented. It's something that was there. I just happened to discover it. And other people will use this pattern, and they'll see it, and they'll use it in different ways. I'm probably just the first to start using it in that sense. And I hope it does improve the way people see things, because seeing the wider picture means that you're more inclusive. You're going to be able to understand other people's opinions and other people's attitudes differently and see it from all sides. And, that's what it's done for me, personally.
Okay, and then we have from Glenn Jewett, the most common misconception is that because you speak the same language, you are communicating.
Yeah, that's true. And reaching people It's a very interesting subject because it's something I didn't touch on today, but it's the subconscious element in it. We subconsciously have connections to words that we're just unaware of. It's just like tapping into the subconscious nature of words, the synchronicity of language. And that has improved the way I've been able to communicate. I'll never forget my wife when I first started using this tool. And I went inside, and I've been a writer for years. I mean, you know, I was just surprised by her response. And I just used this to write. And she said, "Who wrote that?" And it's been like that ever since. I've felt that I stepped up a level in the way that I write, and quite definitely. And, you know, I think that can happen for everyone else who can use it.
And then we have a response from Lon McClure. "Good to know. Thanks for your hard work on this." I have to agree. This is just astounding. It's like, so, you know, the bottom line, the way I think of it, is that you don't have to second guess Google or any search engine. And it's all just laid out for you, and it's just quite astounding. It's really astounding. Mm. Anyway, Peter, thank you so much. We're running out of time here.
I love being here very much
for all of this. It's just mind-boggling. This is doing some conceptual juggling here. Yeah. And thank you all the Zapsters for and wonderful comments and questions. Didn't have time to bring them all up, but
I'll have a look
afterwards. Along. And next week we have Jason T. Weiser, so it's going to be intenso time. So come back next week. Thank you all, and we'll see you next week. Ciao.
Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you.
Bye.